You actually provided a very natural, nice transition to Rose Gottemoeller, Undersecretary of Arms Control and International Security for us at the U.S. Department of State. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Arun. And like Lacina, I'm really honored and delighted to be here. And like Lacina, I'd like to start with Jonathan Fanton, thanking you for the invitation. But also, I liked very much what you said at the end of your remarks. We don't have the luxury to surrender to skepticism. And that, I would say, has been my watchword in this process over the past several years. And I've appreciated my opportunities around the country to talk to younger audiences, to talk to student groups, whether in Utah, in New Mexico, up in Alaska. I've been all over the place in states where we have tested nuclear weapons or that are downwind of the nuclear test site and so suffered from radioactive contamination back in the 1950s and 60s when we were still testing in the atmosphere. So it's wonderful to see you here from Maine today. Thank you very much for coming, and I really enjoyed the chance to talk to you. We did not test nuclear weapons in Maine, but it doesn't matter. Just as Lacina said, we want you to be involved in this process. Lacina did a good job outlining the amazing value of the CTBTO and its work with the International Monitoring System. So what I want to do in my remarks is concentrate on the U.S. process to ratify the treaty. We have a lot of work to do to remind the American public of the enormous value of this treaty to U.S. national security. So I'll start my remarks with a few words about the road that we've traveled so far. There were over 2,000 nuclear explosive tests that took place around the world over the past 71 years. In this century, since 2000, only North Korea has tested, however, so I consider it somewhat of a victory that the moratorium that was put in place in the 1990s on explosive nuclear testing on a voluntary basis is so far holding pretty well. But we can't count on that. There are pressures on the moratorium at every turn. Lacina mentioned I was just in Pakistan and India. They recommitted to the moratorium again, but we know from watching the development of their nuclear arsenals that they are itching to test. They would really like to get out there and develop some new nuclear weapons capabilities. So we need to get to the point where we have a legally enforced treaty, both to strengthen the norm, but also to give us the way to monitor and verify compliance with the treaty. So it's very, very important, this treaty for US national security. Just the above ground tests I mentioned a moment ago created a wealth of problems for health around the world, but here in the United States, I remember very well when I was a child how radioactive and cancer-causing particles such as strontium-90 got into the milk supply, into the food supply, and led at that time to a lot of concern among parents, among mothers, about explosive nuclear testing in the atmosphere. And that was the first push. But then that collided with a major crisis in our history, the Cuban Missile Crisis, and it gave President Kennedy the opportunity to step forward and say, we need to begin the process of banning nuclear weapons. And he was able to take a significant step in that direction just in 1 year, negotiating and bringing into force a limited test ban treaty that that banned those atmospheric testing explosions that were causing the problems with the food supply. That happened in 1963. Years later, it took years, we moved forward to a threshold test ban treaty in the early 1990s, placing additional constraints on nuclear testing. But only in the mid-1990s were we able to negotiate a verifiable comprehensive test ban treaty, banning all nuclear explosive testing. The United States did sign the CTBT. In fact, our president at the time, President Clinton, was the very first to sign the treaty. But we have not been able to bring it to ratify it. The Senate in 1999 failed to give its advice and consent to ratification. And at that time, the senators gave two reasons. They said, how do we know this thing can be verified? How do we know it can be properly monitored? You've promised us an international monitoring system, but it hasn't been built yet. How do we know it's going to be built? How do we know the whole world will join in putting these sites on their territory? Seismic sites, radioactive nuclide sensing sites, infrasound sites. How do we know the world will join in this effort? So that was one question the senators asked. The second question was about how we would maintain our own stockpile without explosive nuclear testing for as long as nuclear weapons continue to exist. They said, you know, at the time they didn't believe that the science-based stockpile stewardship program, which our laboratories was just beginning to undertake, would actually be able to maintain the arsenal without explosive nuclear testing. Sig is going to talk more about that, so I'm not going to get into it more, but I do want to say that the stockpile stewardship program that the Department of Energy maintains with our national laboratories has been very successful. We believe, and our laboratories believe, that we actually understand more nowadays about how nuclear weapons work, thanks to the science-based stockpile stewardship program, than during the period of nuclear explosive testing. And just a few more words about the IMS system. It is the heart of the verification regime for the treaty, but in addition to which, there is the opportunity for on-site inspection. 2 years ago, in December of 2014, I was able to attend the on-site inspection exercise that took place in Jordan, and it was amazing, again, to see countries from all over the world, including some countries you wouldn't expect to be working together, Iran and Israel, working together at this this experiment to see whether the treaty could be verified through on-site inspection. So we have come a long, long way since 1999, and I think we're in good shape to talk to the senators about the treaty from the perspective of those two questions that were raised in 1999. But beyond that, there are other significant reasons why this treaty is in the national security interest of the United States. And I circle back specifically to the problem I raised at the outset. India and Pakistan interested in developing more and different types of nuclear weapons, modernizing the capabilities they already have available. China developing and modernizing its nuclear arsenals. There are pressures on nuclear testing that we must be concerned about, and I see the treaty as a clear and significant way to place barriers in the way of a nuclear arms race in Asia, a nuclear arms race that would profoundly affect the national security of the United States going forward. And of course, countries around the world, but for you and for the rest of the American public, we need to think about what's in our national security interest. And halting an arms race in Asia, I think, or placing barriers in the way of an arms race in Asia is a significant way to do so. Now, how do we go about it? The first way is exactly what we're doing today, to have a conversation with the public. And again, I've been all over the country. Did any of you know that we tested nuclear weapons in Mississippi? Believe it or not, there were tests conducted there in salt domes, and I went to Ole Miss, I went to the University of Mississippi in the spring to talk to students there, and there were actually students in the journalism school who had made a really, really interesting film about that testing series and what happened afterwards in terms of contamination. So if you're interested, check out Atomic Mississippi. You can find it on YouTube. It's a really, really interesting film. And it was made by students at the university there. So there are young people who are getting excited about this. I was glad to have the chance to talk to our students from Maine today, because I feel that once students learn about what's going on here and what the treaty can do for the United States and for our national security, it becomes a no-brainer. But that's the type of thing that we have to do with people around the country, young and old, to make clear the value of this treaty to the United States. When we get it to Capitol Hill, we've got to take the same kinds of approach we took with ratification of the New START Treaty, and that is let the senators ask a lot of questions, briefings, hearings, individual question and answer sessions. New START had over 1,000 questions for the record, but I found that the senators really wanted to dig down deep about the value of that treaty for U.S. national security, and I am confident that once we take the treaty up to the Hill and start to talk about the value of the comprehensive test ban for U.S. national security, we will be able to make that case very, very clearly. But we have a lot of work to do. There's no question about it. Nevertheless, I think we have an excellent case to make. And as former Reagan-era Secretary of State George Shultz said, senators might have been right voting against the CTBT some years ago, but they would be right voting for it now. So thank you very much. I look forward to your questions.